Hello, everyone, and welcome to another theater company's BIPOC in theater panel. The purpose of this panel is for us to share our experiences, perspectives, and discuss ways we can promote progression and inclusivity in the Utah theater community. This panel is part of another theater company's panel series, featuring a number of topics centering on diversity and inclusivity. We have two more panels coming up. We have LGBTQ+ in theater on February the 4th. And then we have Trans in Theater on March 4th. And all panels can be streamed directly from another theater company's YouTube channel. Another theater company is based in Provo, Utah, and centers on bringing alternative voices to life and fostering a home for a different kind of theater in Utah County. It's been a rough year for the theater community, and we appreciate your support. If you would like to make a tax-deductible donation to another theater company, please visit the website at anothertheater.org and hit that donate button on the top left corner of the webpage. Our discussion today features a number of theater artists in the Black, Indigenous, and people of color community. So thank you to everyone for joining us today to share our thoughts and experiences as artists of color. Before we get started on our discussion questions, let's go around our virtual room and introduce our panelists. I'll go first and then I'll call on each of you for introductions. So my name is Janice Chan, and I'm the moderator for our panel this evening. My pronouns are she, her, and I'm a scenic designer based in Utah County. And I'm currently designing a couple of productions at a local university. Lucas, would you like to go next?
Yeah, thanks, Janice. My name is Lucas. My pronouns are he, him, and I am not currently doing anything. Oh, I lied. I am actually preparing to be in a production of Spring Awakening done by Pink Neon Productions, as well as being a dresser for the Hale Center Theater Sandy for Les Mis.
Great. Song?
Hi, I'm Seung Choi. He, his, him. I'm currently a student at UVU. I just got done with a Christmas carol at Hale Center Theater Orem. Loved my time, and yeah.
Okay, Archie?
Oh, there we go. Hi, Archie Crisanto, Archelaus Crisanto. My pronouns are he, his, him. Currently, I am surviving this pandemic, and hopefully it will blow over soon. As far as creative endeavors, if you got any, hey, I'm free.
Thanks. Latoya?
Hi, all. I'm Latoya Cameron. I go by she, her, and hers. I live in Salt Lake City. That's where I do most of my acting. I'm an actress. I'm going to be doing a podcast version of Julie Jensen's new play called PG Non with Plan B Theater Company. We're broadcasting sometime in like February into March, I believe, if I'm correct. And lots of new stuff in development. And hopefully we'll be able to announce that sometime this year, but definitely working towards some new stuff. So yeah.
Awesome. Abhi?
Hello, everyone. My name is Abhi Harikumar. My pronouns are he, him, his. I'm a student at the University of Utah studying information systems. In terms of creative endeavors, COVID's kind of put a little bit of a damper on that. So I'm just going to school, trying to focus on my degree. I've just been mostly trying to do service projects and helping people out here and there because of COVID. And so, looking forward to getting back into acting and doing creative things once all of this lets up and we're able to be around each other again.
Yeah. Keslie?
Unmuting is so fun. my name is Keslie. My pronouns are she, her. Currently, during the pandemic, I am not doing anything, taking a break. I'm pursuing more physical forms of art, so studio art, but I'm looking forward to getting back into auditioning when more theaters are opening up and there's more opportunities.
Great. And Courtney?
Yeah, Courtney Dilmore, but Hi, my name is Courtney Dilmore. She and her, my pronouns. I am from the Diné Nation, and my what I do, everything that I do, I'm an actor, a makeup artist, and what else do I do? I'm a playwright, stage manager, anything I can possibly do, I do. During COVID, I have been actually doing a lot of collaborations with a lot of playwrights. I've had so many of them reach out to me. That has been probably one of the best things that has ever happened to ever come about from this whole thing. So I have been also donating and supporting local artists in a lot of the Indigenous youth communities. So those are a couple of those things are coming up here real soon. So that's all I've been doing.
Awesome. Thank you all. So we touched on this a little bit, but as we head into our panel discussion, our first question relates to the pandemic and how it's affecting the BIPOC community and the theater artists. So how has the COVID-19 pandemic affected you, your community, and you as theater artists? It's been hard, but Archie, did you want to say something?
So I ended up getting my union card at the end of last year, and I was looking forward to, with high hopes of starting some more union work this year. Of course, that definitely changed. I think for me, because of the scarcity of work in a lot of cases, it's forced me to kind of reevaluate what I want out of theater and what I want out of storytelling, filmmaking, et cetera, because, you know, it wasn't just theater that was affected. It was, I do a lot of commercial work as well. And yeah, a lot of people just kind of doubled down on doing, you know, very small productions and kind of scraping together what they could. And it's kind of led me to, I think, take a step back and go, this is good. I'm glad people are working. And I'm glad people have work to give. But like, it's this like weird question that's bothering me. It was like, I want to be responsible and I want to be safe, but I also want to work my craft.
Yeah, definitely. And that's something that I thought about too, is refocusing on what matters in terms of my craft. And I have never had to think about this before, like ethics, right? Like if I take on this project, am I looking at this in a larger picture, the larger perspective? Is it safe? And who is it affecting? This whole pandemic has really forced me to look at my career in a different light.
To kind of build off of that, I think this pandemic has really answered a lot of questions I had about like the accessibility of theater and how do we make theater a lot more inclusive and able to be accessed by different groups of people. The most notable example I can think of is probably what The Fringe did this year in terms of getting a bunch of artists and having them film their performances and just allowing people to watch from the comfort of their homes. And while it's regrettable that like I don't get to go see theater with my loved ones, it's awesome to see theater now becoming a thing that people can enjoy in a much more easier way. And I'm sure for many people who hadn't had the opportunity to go see it before, this is a very, very exciting time for all of that stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was gonna say, we brought up great points, and like just recently I watched like Ratatouille the musical, and the idea that like it blew all of this money out of the water, that people were shocked that in a day, you know, they had broken a million. But understanding that theater, while being enjoyed, should also be affordable to people all over. You know, it was so easy for people to be able to chip in $5, $10 to watch a recording of a concert version, you know, and just to put that out there instead of, you know, having this idea that we have to spend hundreds of dollars to go on a trip and like go see these shows in person. There's like other ways to create the art and get it to people and make it more accessible.
Definitely.
Wanted to piggyback on that, that thought too. I just think it's interesting how when this whole thing happened, it just really allowed the opportunity to stop if people allowed themselves to, because I think people, you know, especially as artists, we start to freak out a little bit of like, this is what we do, this is who we are. And then separating ourselves from this is who we are because based upon what we do, I have found for myself that it actually was a detriment because I started losing my own identity within what I was doing. And then realizing also that playing the game of the theater thing wasn't really doing anything for me as well. Like the kind of expansion that I want to have for myself as an artist and the kind of expansion I want to see in storytelling and the inclusivity and stuff like that was not happening. As much as I was fighting for it, I didn't see it fruition throughout all of, you know, Utah, as much as I think and know that it can. So I really noticed myself being very, very upset and frustrated and almost at a point of like that rage of being like, wow, I was a part of something that I thought was going to be life-changing and realizing that there's still so much work to do to get to that life-changing effect that I feel like a lot of artists get into theater in the first place, or at least storytelling or some kind of artistic expressive kind of avenue that we go into, you know. So I feel like when the pandemic happened, I was in a show actually, and we of course got postponed, and after I freaked out I was like, oh wow, this is what I've been doing for the last how many years I've been acting, and now it's like really taking the opportunity to see what I could do in igniting a change versus just being in rage mode, you know, using that fire to actually cause change. So I don't know what the answers are, obviously, but knowing that at least it gives me a different focus of where I was at the beginning of my career. Now I have maybe more of an actual focus, if that makes any sense.
Yeah.
I'm gonna piggyback off Latoya. I loved that so much. I think for me, especially during this pandemic time, it was kind of the opposite for me. So it's really inspiring to hear you say that, to like that there is such a bigger picture that we're fighting for in general. But for me, like when the pandemic hit, I had just finished a show and I think I lost my drive. Like I kind of just lost that creative drive inside of me to want to do it anymore, you know, especially because there were so many theaters shutting down. Like, man, it's going to be so hard to even find a theater that's open, that's doing a show that I could even audition for, especially just like as a person of color, you know, just you have to find those roles that you can be and fit in for them. And so I just kind of not gave up, but a little bit. I haven't been in a show since the pandemic started. I know a lot of people haven't, but, and there's been opportunities, you know, for me to audition for things, but I just, mental health wise, it just really got to me. So I think it's very inspiring. So thank you for that. But yeah, that's just kind of how it affected me. And I'm still trying to find, you know, like for me as not just a performer, but a storyteller, how I want to tell stories, like in what way, in what form, and what drive do I have to make those stories happen? Especially like stories of my own, even. It's here in Utah, right? We're talking about, you know, people of color and how we experience art, theater, interaction with everybody. Like, what stories do I have to tell to help, you know, fight the fight that we're fighting and use that fire that Latoya is talking about to change our world that we exist in? So I'm still exploring and trying to figure that out. And I think right now it's been good to have that reflection, but it's also been kind of a hindrance on me as an artist as well.
Yeah, I love that so much. I think it's so important. I just haven't had a lot of time to self-reflect, just being on the grind constantly from, you know, finishing school to like just always looking for the next project, that I just never had downtime to really think about, you know, what I'm doing and what kind of impact I'm making. So thank you all for sharing. So our next question is, if you have had college theater experiences, how were they challenging for you to navigate? And how were your experiences different for you compared to your peers?
I would like to go first on that, if that's all right. So I got into theater quite late in life. And what made it so challenging was that being, you know, I think I was about 27 when I really discovered theater. And I was going to school with not just some freshmen, but also, you know, kids who had been doing it since they were like in middle school or had discovered it quite a long time. And that accessibility for myself was never available. And so it was just a whole brand new world to me. And for a lot of the professors and a lot of the other students to kind of expect me to know, like, hello, you know, that's how it works, or this is how we do this, or this is how we do that. It was so like, oh, I'm sorry. I didn't know that's what I was supposed to do, you know? There was like a norm and there was like a level that I had no idea even existed within the college realm. And so it was finding my own path, for one, and two, I kind of carried this hindrance on my shoulder because I did film and television before I did theater, and I was told by actually a casting director that I should never, ever audition for lead roles, ever. I didn't have the face for it. I didn't have anything for it, and I was just like, okay, so I got that mindset of that's what I shouldn't be doing, even though I still wanted to, you know, be an actor. And to go and audition in college, it was almost the same, exact same experience, but just not so much being told that directly. It was the feeling that I got from every single audition. So there was another thing. So it kind of felt like I got pushed to have to find other niches for myself. So that's where hair and makeup design came in. And that's when I got shoved into, like, I feel like I got shoved into stage management, but in the end, I'm very grateful that I did, because I learned quite a bit from that. And then playwriting. So all the other things other than where I really wanted to be.
I kind of want to share my experience here. So I started theater really late, just like Courtney. Didn't do theater until I got into college. And it was fascinating how I get to create this whole different world and just provide it for the audiences, and so that they can experience the life that they never lived before. And as I pursued this career and studying in school, it was quite interesting, because I had some people telling me that, oh, the only reason why you're getting into this and that are just because you're Asian. And also there are other people telling me, oh, like, it's, you're not gonna get into any shows because you're Asian. And I'm like, so where does this lead to? And I don't know, every single class, almost every single class, I had this pressure that I need to put so much more time and effort to not anyone to make fun of me, you know? And since English is my third language, it takes more time and effort for me to even like memorize and get stuff done. And I also got into a toxic relationship with myself at one point, and it was quite hard, but I learned that I had to surround myself with positive people in this harsh environment. And yeah, still in college, but I think I haven't found my way.
I really like what you said, Seung. I kind of had a similar experience where people, you know, on the one hand, people would be telling me, oh, you're so lucky to be doing theater. You're a man of color in Utah. And then on the other hand, I'd have people telling me, oh, you're a man of color in Utah. Good luck getting roles, right? And I think especially, like, there was a weird kind of contradiction there that I didn't really know how to deal with. And especially when I first started doing theater toward the tail end of high school and, like, at the beginning of college, I didn't really know how to think of myself as an artist, and I didn't know how other people would be thinking of me as an artist. Definitely, like, growing up in Utah as an immigrant, I've kind of become trained to the idea that in most social interactions, people are going to notice, like, the color of my skin before they notice really anything else about me. And to a lot of people, that's going to be the first thing that they think about. And, you know, getting into that sort of mindset as an actor and just, you know, you have your pre-show jitters, but, like, when it's tied to the color of your skin before you go on stage, you're like, I wonder what people are going to think of me in this role because I'm brown. Like, that is a whole new level of stress, and definitely didn't, you know, it wasn't helped by some of the comments that a lot of people had made. And it was definitely really tricky navigating that space within my head. And it was also sort of compounded by the fact that, you know, despite some people telling me that there were plenty of roles for me out there, the roles that were, like, for me were never, like, you guys know what I'm saying. It wasn't great roles. It wasn't really anything I was excited about. And the roles that were specifically designed for someone that looked like me, I walked away feeling like, did I just sell myself out for, like, someone else's enjoyment? Like, this is a good role, I guess. And I don't know. I don't have all the answers whether, like, every role that I took was maybe good for me or not. And I think, especially in the Utah theater scene, there weren't a whole lot of other people that I could dialogue with to maybe, like, get their perspective. Like, I could talk to my, like, white artist friends and be like, hey, what do you think of me doing an accent on stage? And I'd get, like, a, you know, less than great answer from them. So it was definitely, I think, being an actor of color here is a very tricky space to navigate, and you're getting a lot of conflicting information at all times.
Yeah, so I have to just preface this with, so I'm representing the mixed race. So I'm actually half Hispanic, half white. And my experiences with this, while, like, I just wanted to say, like, I understand that I have come from privilege in certain aspects, but with this, I didn't have a lot of college experiences. It wasn't like, I just kind of did shows here and there, but when I was in high school, because I have a little bit more olive to my skin, I got cast in a couple roles that were actually meant for other ethnicities, like a Nubian and Aida, or I played someone who was supposed to be of Middle Eastern descent at one point. And it was always because people told me that I didn't look almost, it sounds dumb, but, like, I didn't look white enough, where people would say, like, and other actors, I've had other actors tell me it as well, where I've had people in dressing rooms say, well, yeah, but you're also more Asian looking, or you're, like, because of your skin tone, like, it's hard to tell, but it's things like that that, like, hurt. And I actually was asked to audition for a role of someone who was Hispanic, and they spoke Spanish. And I was offered the role because I'm half Mexican. But I had a point where I ended up auditioning, but I didn't feel good about it because I had to do a English Spanish accent. And I can sort of speak Spanish, but not enough that it sounds native. That it was hard because then it was put into, like, the idea of, like, well, I actually really shouldn't be auditioning for this. Because, like, someone of color should be this role. Someone who speaks this language natively should play this. And I think it, like, that was the first time that really brought me to this discussion and like hearing people's stories. And this was only within like the past couple years, but hearing these stories, there is so much work. And like, even for me, like there's work to be done for people of color, stories to be heard and told, and in the appropriate way.
I feel like I should piggyback off of that too. Only because like what you said, it's interesting. I think, especially here in Utah, unfortunately, we have, there's so many shows that we just, we have the appropriate culture, like to represent the actual cultures here. It's just the laziness that the theater companies are like, oh, they're not here or whatever. And I'm like, yes, we're all here. You just need to do better. And it's not our responsibility to do better for you. You get to do the work. So, I mean, it's interesting reflecting on this time of reflection and stuff like that, where I'm like, okay, what plays have I done that I get to take off my resume? Because I was not I shouldn't have been accepting that role at all. Like, there was In the Heights I did, and I played Daniela. I should have never done that role ever. And it's something like that where I'm like, I knew in my guts, I was like, I remember apologizing so much to everyone in the cast and just being like, I hope I'm representing it correctly. Like, da, da, da. And I just felt like it was wrong the whole time doing it. And so it's like, now that I'm here, I'm like, oh yeah, I should have said no. And on the flip side too of the conversation, like, it's interesting some of the opportunities that come to you that you think that you aren't supposed to be a part of, that you are supposed to be a part of. There was a play that came up years ago, so many years ago now, God, almost 10, that was an open audition and stuff like that. And I remember going and just being like, I'm just going to go and audition. And I got called back, and I got called back for the lead role. And I was like, I'm definitely not going to get that role because they're never going to cast a Black woman as the lead. So I'll be lucky if I get to play the prostitute just to be a part of the show, you know? And I kept getting called back for the lead role. And I was just like, because I felt like I had nothing to lose because I felt like it didn't happen anyway. So I was just like, I was surprised. And then I was surprised when I got offered the lead role. And I was like confused because I didn't think that that was going to ever happen. When I look back at my career, there has been evidence of that happening, because I like to push boundaries that really never were there, because I wanted to do a show because I felt passionate for this role. I felt like I can relate to this character. And even regardless of it saying they were looking for a Caucasian person or whatever, I'm like, but I can relate to this character. And there's nothing in the script that says that it's specifically for this one race. It could be anything, and I can be that role. So sometimes I'd show up for those roles and I would get them, and sometimes I wouldn't. But it's stuff like that where that play, when I was like, oh no, we want you to play their lead role. It's interesting how we unfortunately succumb to those kinds of mindsets that we aren't supposed to be in that space when we always have been a part of that space. It's just like saying no to all those people who have been shutting the doors on us, if that makes any sense, especially for me. Like, it's time to like really be like, no, I'm pushing the door. And even if you try to shut it, I'm going to push back, you know? So I don't know what I'm trying to say, but those are my thoughts that came to me when I was listening to Lucas.
Yeah, definitely. I feel like a lot of times that we feel othered, even when we've done nothing, just simply by showing up, sometimes we just feel othered, which brings me to my next question for the group. Have you had any challenging experiences in your career, and what made those experiences difficult as a professional, and what you wish could have happened instead or could have changed?
I think, go ahead, you got it.
So a few years ago, I was trying to get a production of Twelfth Night off the ground. And I'm really passionate about using Shakespeare, or I mean any storytelling, but to contextualize, in this case, racial relationships that people, you know, wouldn't think about. I know that a lot of the times when Twelfth Night gets, you know, produced, a lot of things about gender roles and things of that nature are put at the forefront. And this I'm going on too long, but this particular production, I felt really, really passionate about, like, setting it in New Orleans and the middle of ragtime. I watched like Princess and the Frog, and I was like, hey, this makes sense to me. But I wanted to kind of pay homage to that culture, Cajun and Creole. And I did a lot of research and tried to make sure we could do this as authentically as possible. And the creative director that I was working with, they would kind of stifle my voice whenever I insisted upon something cultural, something of cultural relevance to a show. Like, you know, hey, I just really want this type of music to be prominent in the show. I'm looking for a New Orleans jazz band because that's something that's really endemic, you know, that's for example. And they kept trying to suggest like pop songs, and there was a lot of choices that I was making with the actors and everything to kind of honor what the United States and particularly New Orleans looked like at the time, that would kind of get glossed over, and they would try to whitewash everything. And I found that it's very difficult to try and represent culture here in Utah without having, I don't know how else to put this like delicately, but without having other voices trying to whitewash it, basically, trying to make it more palatable for general audiences. Oh, people aren't going to be into that. People are going to be, or on the flip side, kind of utilizing culture in this weird way to, oh, look, it's ethnic, it's cool. You know, come see us and look what we're doing for diversity, but without putting in the legwork to do that. And that's been a huge issue for me, over the years here.
To go off kind of what you said, I was recently in a production of Aida, and I am by no means of African descent. I'm representing the Polynesian community. But one, to go off of a little bit of the whitewashing, or maybe not really understanding the significance of the cultural aspects of the art that we're trying to portray, there's dancing in Aida. If you've ever seen Aida, there's some numbers where there's dance breaks, and a lot of those dance breaks, like even on Broadway and the professional performances of Aida, there are specific, you know, moves, and a lot of them are inspired by African dance moves. And the choreographer of the production that I was in had said she took a couple of African dance classes, and kind of that was her thing. She went from there and she kind of choreographed the dance. And me, I have an extensive dance background where I've done a lot of, I do like Polynesian dance, but I also have studied African movement with specific teachers who are from Africa. And, you know, there are specific movements you do for specific celebrations or grieving movements. And it showed and told me that, you know, she kind of just basically choreographed the number based off of the dance moves that she learned. There wasn't very much further research done as to why we're doing these dance moves and what specific dance moves represent what situation you're in. And at that point, it was kind of hard for me because I was a part of something that I don't think I should have been a part of. And back to what Latoya was saying, they didn't do the heavy work in finding the correct people to portray and tell this story. There was a Baptist church, there were a couple Baptist churches right next to, you know, where we rehearsed. There are so many places that people could have reached out to the community to try and bring in people to correctly represent what was being told in the story, and none of that was done. And by then it's one of those moral, ethical situations in your head where you're just kind of like, I'm already doing the show. What do I do? How do I make it as authentic as possible? I'm not even African-American, I'm Polynesian. And it was kind of one of those pivotal moments in my life where I decided that the art that I auditioned for, the art that I'm a part of, for me, needs to be more meaningful and needs to be told like correctly. And, you know, and you'd think that that would be kind of just in the forefront of your mind all the time, but it gets hard when you're constantly auditioning for billions of shows. And at some point you're just like, man, I just want to be in something. Or if you need like money and you're just wanting to work for a film, you get lost in that. So I think it's really, really important, especially for us as people of color in a community that's not as supportive as it could be, to stay grounded and define the things that keep us grounded, especially cultural wise. So,
I really like you bringing that up. And I you know, I this conversation has just caused me to kind of reflect on, you know, the kinds of maybe even boxes that like we put ourselves in based on what we hear other people saying about us. And how that might, you know, inform our decision to maybe take on a role that's not really good for us or was meant for us.
All these conversations, sorry to kind of jump in again, but all these conversations just reminded me of, you know, whenever a quote unquote like ethnic show gets put on in Utah specifically, you know, I'm sure a lot of you have experienced this, but we'll get emails or we'll get texts of, hey, you know, so-and-so is doing this. Maybe you should think about auditioning. I don't know. And then, you know, yeah, they really need like a diverse ensemble. It's like, well, ensemble? I mean, ensemble work is great and everything, you know, but why did you go there? Why is that? Why is that the first thing you thought of when you thought of me? But it's funny, you know, because, you know, nobody ever asked me to be Gomez in Adam's Family. And, you know, nobody's ever asked me to, I can't think of a show right now. But yeah, like those other shows, those other quote unquote big spectacular shows that we do normally or that are normally put on here, it's funny because I don't ever get emails about those of being invited to participate there. And I think it's really interesting what we get invited to.
Can I just say, it just made me think that it's also those shows that like need to be looked at again. Like, for example, and this isn't a slander on any theater, this is just a specific play. But like Sung and I did Anything Goes a few years ago. And actually, thankfully, like people, it was like talked about then, but like that show, while was written many years ago, needs to be relooked at because of racial aspects. And like, it shows like that that come up, that have these roles that kind of show like these terrible stereotypes, you know? And but theaters just keep doing them, especially because if in Utah, like the person likes it, like, or if the mass crowd likes it, then, you know, they put it on, it's easy money, people will come see it. But there's a lot of those shows that like, you know, if we're gonna do West Side Story, stop and find the right culture to bring in for that, you know? And if you can't find that and you know that that's not gonna work, then do a different story, You know, it's looking at all of these shows that a lot of people have come to love and understanding that, like, okay, but we understand that, like, maybe the rest of it's great, but if that one part is not and is, like, causing these damaging stereotypes and things like that, like, it shouldn't, you know, be done, or it needs to be rewritten or looked at, you know?
And then I would challenge them too. Cause I'm like, I also don't want people to, like, if they do a show and they're like, we want to do, because it's the most basic of basic, but Once on This Island, if we want to do Once on This Island and we don't have, like, you know, we don't find the people, our, you know, Black, ensemble and leads and all that stuff, like, for that show, then let's not do it, you know, because I feel like it's an easy way out for them to be like, well, we didn't find them, so let's not do it. But we tried, pat on the back, and then they'll move forward and do Anything Goes, right? I feel like if they're going to do anything, like, let's say Music Man, the most Utah shows, they're going to always pick a Music Man or a Joseph or whatever, which is fine. No disrespect. Like, we all like what we like. And also, why can't, Harold Hill be of any ethnicity, you know? Like, that would be so beautiful to see that. Like, there's no reference in the musical, in the script, that he is white, you know, so it could be anyone. Why can't Joseph, you know, why can't he be anything, you know? Like, why can't the narrator be anything? She's a narrator, for Pete's sake, you know, so why can't she be anything versus another white person, you know? So I often want to challenge people, just like in Utah culture, like, it just, because if you can't find the people to do the show, then you're not working hard enough, first off. And think outside of the box as well, because we all don't want to be continuously doing, you know, West Side Stories and Once on This Island and In the Heights, although all awesome shows, but, like, I would love to do, you know, those classics as well and be a part of those storytellings as well, because it can be anybody, you know. It's theater, you know, like, that's kind of like, it's theater, for Pete's sake. So why are we encouraged as artists to only have an imagination when the theater is having a lack of imagination? So
definitely.
While attending a college or university in Utah, I did a study abroad program to London, and I think the biggest thing that I took away from that experience was that they place people on stage no matter what they look like, and it was probably one of the most mind-blowing things I had ever seen before. And then I learned later on that, like, they did this Bollywood theme for at the Globe, Shakespeare's Globe, for Midsummer Night's Dream. And there was even, I believe, one of the women characters was actually played by a man. And so they were just doing all kinds of different stuff. And then later on, we learned that the artistic director they hired was actually a person of color. And it was absolutely fabulous. I was like, this is probably the best thing that the Globe may have ever done. And it was just this mind-blowing experience. And so it just made me think differently about how I accept people's, those emails that we were talking about, you know. It just made me think differently of, like, no, I'm more capable and probably worth a little bit more time than that. Like, I'm very careful to evaluate, and it helped me get over, you know, what that one casting director told me years ago, to never audition for the lead roles or be the ingenue character or whatever. And it kind of just turned that around. I'm like, no, I am definitely worth a little more. And I have just as much talent as anybody here, if you give it a chance to look differently and to bring in a different perspective. And that's probably what a lot of us would do, but just, it's the opportunity's not there yet, or nobody wants to see it different just yet. And I really hope that with this year, that we start to see some of those things change. And one of those things that I actually started to see was that, also again in university when I was taking a playwriting class, my stories were much, much different than everybody else's stories. And in those classes, we have to read each other's stories. And a lot of mine took place on the reservation. It was about reservation life. And people just didn't understand why things were happening the way they were happening in my stories. And I was, and you know, people were just like, well, maybe if you change this, or maybe if you did that. And I'm like, no, because that's not how it happens. And that's not going to be believable. And this is my story. So this is how it's going to happen. So I think now people are starting to appreciate a little bit of those different flavors and storylines and the things that we can bring to the community. So I hope anyone and all of you also listening to this are just realize that you are worth more than you ever thought you were on stage, on film, on camera, on whatever. So stick true to your story, stick true to your identity, because it's fabulous just the way you are. So.
Yeah, thank you, Courtney. That's, yeah, that's wonderful. And it's a great transition to our next question, which is considering the Black Lives Matter movement, which started in 2013, and the more recent events following the murder of George Floyd in May, how have your experiences in the theater changed in the last 7 months? And have they changed? Are schools, companies, or institutions making an impact?
Kind of at the beginning of the year, when everything was really starting to get heated up, Latoya and I actually, we were part of a private panel with one of the more prominent theaters in Salt Lake. And we got the opportunity to really actually directly address, you know, one of the creative directors about racial issues and what we as the BIPOC community face in theater and storytelling. And it was really enlightening. And one thing that really stuck with me, Latoya, was when we were talking to this person, because I came through theater and storytelling and filmmaking through a very unorthodox route. I didn't go to school or anything like that. I just, you know, kind of stumbled my way onto set and pretended I belonged there. And I've been there ever since. But Latoya talked about how, and Seung touched upon this earlier when he was talking about it, how we almost have to work harder to be normal, to represent ourselves well, to not be the, you know, the loud Black woman, to not be the difficult minority, to not be the, you know, the brown guy who doesn't get it, or, you know, whatever. And as it articulated something that I had felt in, you know, the storytelling industries, but it had never been able to quite get out. And I think that was really enlightening for me, along with a lot of other stuff we talked about in that panel.
Yeah,
I I was just about to mention I am the prominent theater. I believe I know which situation you're discussing. There has since been a diverse, I can't remember the title that this person has gained, but there's now like a diversity coordinator at a prominent theater here in Utah, to kind of help bring in diversity to every audition. And I've gotten those emails where it's like, hey, we obviously know you're a person of color. Please come in and audition for this show. And I don't know that it's made a difference. Like, I don't know. I think the idea is great, but I still think the approach is we're still doing shows, like you guys have addressed before, that that need to be re-looked at, or that just don't, or I guess creative directors who are directing those shows, that in their mind they don't see it as, you know, kind of an all people cast. Like I think we just need different shows, you know, different stories to tell. Like, as a Polynesian person in theater, there are no plays, really, or musicals written about any part of my culture. I've never once read a play written about my culture. And it doesn't necessarily, and I'm not saying it has to be about, you know, specific cultures, but it's just not inclusive, the things that we're doing. So instead of, you know, yes, it's great getting more diversity to come into the shows, but maybe change your shows. You know, that's really where you should be focusing on. Like everybody else has been saying, you know, maybe change your creative perspective in the show that you're doing. There's so many opportunities for us to, I mean, Hamilton, everybody talks about Hamilton. It's some people love it, some people hate it, but really they did something different. They told a story and it didn't matter what color you were, how tall you were, you know, they told a story and it was beautiful. And we all understood the story. We all got the moral of the story. And I think no one's really taking that approach right now. We were gifted, you know, such a beautiful thing and a door that's open, you know, so many possibilities that we can take from that. And we're not really doing that. So yeah, just piggybacking off that, I think there's still more we could be doing. And I think we're kind of only just scraping the top of the iceberg. You know, we're not really getting into the deep parts that we need to be kind of changing.
So. I would have to agree. There's our thing that we, that private panel was a different theater company than that one, but I know what theater company you're talking about as well, because I was working up with that one too. The whole George Floyd murder really took me to another bout of rage. Just 2020 was rage, just fire, and I just wanted everything to burn. And you know, with destruction, like just without any kind of intention, all it is just destruction. And so, at least for me, and so I was just like, well, what can I do with that, this energy? And so having private panels and talking to people that are in positions of power was something that I knew that I could at least do, although some kind of, it's feels small, but it's a seed that I hope that will keep, you know, growing with holding people accountable and holding them to what they said, because we ain't gonna forget that conversation, you know? So I'm like, that in that space where that kind of behavior was consistently happening and being in those rooms, like it literally is going to take, I will not allow myself to be in spaces like that anymore. Like if someone is being berated for being completely isolated from being in the space, in a creative space, because of what we look like, I will not allow that anymore. I will not be in that space anymore. I will not. And that will take us and other artists to be courageous to do that, I think. Be damned my career. I can say screw that. Like, it's not as important as it will be in making sure that if this theater is going to move into a progressive space, then it needs to. It's overdue. And I can't dwell in a space that's going to continuously stay stagnant, you know? So I can't. So I'm going to hold, like, I'm holding that theater accountable. And they have actually done some certain actions in regards to having further conversations and dialogues, which I was really keeping my eye on. Now this other theater company you're talking about, which I know, I am not surprised. They are, as I can't say any names, I'm not surprised that they are all about the emails that have been talked about in this panel so far, about being like, come on, we want you. It's like, but you really haven't shown that you want us or any of us. And even the person who's taken that position over at that theater hasn't done their work either. Just because one of our BIPOC people takes on a position at a theater company does not mean that the work is over. So, and I'm not surprised that nothing has happened to increase more inclusivity and equity at that theater company. So I'm not surprised that you know, nothing has changed, to be honest. And it will, it really is gonna just take upon a lot of bravery for people to take stances against those kinds of institutions. Because honestly, if we don't, then they're gonna continue to do the same old stuff, you know, because unfortunately the theater has and is a business. And for certain people, that's what it always will be. And it really, as artists, it's gonna take us a lot of work to really know the differentiation between an artistic space and a business. So, and it is going to be not only, obviously, like, it's not our responsibility to just be like, it's, you know, you need to do better. We need really true allies to do that work for us, because we've been doing the work, you know. So yeah, that's, I guess, my rambling about that. But yeah.
I think we're all just exhausted. I know I'm exhausted. So, I mean, I think the Black Lives Matter movement actually didn't really, before this all happened, you know, before George Floyd happened, wasn't really something that I knew much about, which is something I really hate to say. But after leaving Utah and coming to North Dakota, my big city became Minneapolis, Minnesota. So, I mean, they're my neighbor. So that community is actually where I go to a lot for a lot to get, because there is an Indigenous theater company that's over there, and I like to keep up with what they're doing and stuff. And they're actually downtown where everything happened. And so I was like, you know, the support that these two communities gave each other was just one of those moments of like, I think we're gonna be okay, you know. We felt it, they felt it, I think all the other people of colors communities felt it. And so I just know that even though we're exhausted of explaining and telling people everything, I think we're gonna be all right. We're, as you know, a lot of Indigenous people like to say, we are very resilient. So, but.
Yeah, I think with the ease of social media and having to go through this pandemic and be creative with how we tell stories and making storytelling more accessible and all of that together, I think it's a lot easier for us to hold these institutions accountable and to see if they're following through with their hashtag and, you know, seeing the work. And so I'm just really glad that there is that social media, there is that space, the virtual space that we can kind of keep up and kind of see what businesses, what companies we should support for the bigger picture, like we mentioned earlier in this panel.
I'm almost curious if, like, you know, this wave of protests and these rounds of radical change that we're seeing across the country, I've kind of been grappling with the idea of, you know, can art and specifically theater be used to change minds, specifically like maybe the minds of leaders who don't quite understand the positions that a lot of their constituents are in. I kind of had an experience where, you know, I didn't really want to do theater for a while because the first few forms of theater I was introduced to were here in Utah, and it was things like you know, The Wiz and In the Heights, and it was just all white people in spray tans. And that was kind of like, yeah, it was bad. And that was my like introduction to theater, specifically in Utah. And I was like, I don't think this is for me. What got me to change my mind was I'd found out that my high school was doing a production of Disgraced. And for those of you that don't know about it, it deals with issues such as colorism and Islamophobia post 9/11 in New York. And you know, getting, and I mean, the main character was an Indian American, and getting to hear like that, getting to do that project was what made me want to do theater and made and get me to stick in theater. And the reason for that was the most impactful part of the show was getting to talk with people afterwards who just like didn't understand how structural biases and internalized biases work. The character that I played was Muslim, but had a great deal of Islamophobia surrounding his parents and his culture and how he viewed himself. And for like a lot of white people in the audience and a lot of like friends that I had, a lot of parents of friends, that was just never a perspective that they'd ever considered before. And they never considered how insidious racism can be and how it can operate from within a structure. So I don't know, like I'm a little surprised that there hasn't been more done in the Utah theater scene of using theater as a mechanism of conveying experiences to people who don't necessarily know those experiences, like, you know, governors, mayors, politicians, decision makers at large.
Yeah. So last year, before the whole 2020, I did Thriller Modern Merely, but it was very special for me because this time I actually got to rewrite the script with the playwright's permission officially from the New York City. And you know, like when usually people think about Ching-ho and Bun-fu from Thriller Modern Merely, they just think these characters as comedic relief, like funny Asians. It's like Dumb and Dummies, end of the deal. But as an immigrant, I know there are more to these characters. So I actually rewrote these characters into actual immigrants back in 1920s, and actually was able to bring so much more life to these characters. And and the feedback that I got, people were impressed how they actually got to see Ching-ho and Bun-fu as a real human being instead of comedic relief, you know. And of course, like every month, like there's this one racist audience that this person would just laugh, like whenever I'm talking about, like, so I'm speaking Korean, since I'm Korean, so I'm speaking Korean, and then I'm talking about my mother, like back in the mainland, and it was back in 1920s. How heartbreaking is that? Like, they had to cross the oceans, they had to get on the boat, and they didn't have phones or like Skype or anything like that, so they have to write letters, and that's really heartbreaking. And yeah, it was kind of stressful to like deal with those like audiences, but those were very few. But the impact that I was able to bring to this community, that the immigrants are also people and Asians are not just comedic relief, it was really mind-blowing how powerful theater is. As long as you put enough work and research into it, it can work.
Yeah, definitely. Our next question is, who are some of the BIPOC artists you look up to or draw inspiration from?
I'll go first. So this summer I got to work with James Saito. Since he has worked in Hollywood for so many years, I just became a huge fan of him. He gave me so many insightful notes, and we talked about being an Asian man in this industry and what it means. And I also love Lia Salonga because she's also not from America, and I'm not from America. I'm actually a top fan on her Facebook page, and sometimes she shares her stories on her Facebook or like Instagram, and every time I'm like, it's so personal, and I also feel the pain and the growth that she went through, you know. And I don't know, I just love her so much. And Megan Masako is also one of my favorite star right now. She's from Utah, and she graduated BYU with MDT major, and she she got into the Mean Girls national tour as Gretchen, but because of COVID, it got shut down. And yeah.
I am a huge fan of Jordan Peele. I know, is that too big to say here? Like, is that too? But I love what he does with horror and then social issues, because I'm a really huge fan of horror movies, my gosh. But again, I've always loved his sort of magic trick of, I'm going to show you this, but it's really about social issues, but you think it's about this. And then also, does anybody watch Ugly Delicious? I think it's David Chang. I highly recommend it. But he's a chef, actually, and he uses basically the whole conceit of Ugly Delicious is going back to all the things that he liked and shaped him growing up and embracing them, because he's a Korean American. I think he's an immigrant. I'm not sure. But kind of going back a little bit and talking about what, you know, George Floyd and Breonna Taylor, so many other names that, you know, we shouldn't have to say. But it's led me to kind of reevaluate my relationship with art. And I know a lot of us talk about this, but like, I don't care about any other art if it's not going to say something about culture, if it's not going to enlighten audiences about a particular issue. And I know, Latoya, you talked about, and Keslie, just not caring, your career be damned, by calling out injustices and calling out inappropriate things, but then also seeing Jordan Peele and David Chang on the flip side of that, embracing those things that make them different, and finding an audience and finding a way to tell their stories in their own way and enlighten people in a way that I don't think people would have listened without a lot of the radical change that's happening.
Some artists that I think are major influences on how I do my work and how I tell my stories would be, one of them is a playwright. Well, they're both playwrights, actually. but the first one would be Thompson Highway. He's most famous for a show that he wrote called The Red Sisters. It is one, if not the only, indigenous story about seven women. So it's like an ensemble cast, but there's something in there for every indigenous woman in there. So it's actually one of the first shows that I was introduced while doing theater, because it was the only thing that I could do, or, you know, could be cast as. But when I started looking more into his work and where he got his inspiration from, even though, you know, he's a First Nation Canadian Ojibwe and completely different tribe from what I'm from, the relevance was still there across the board. The connections, the cultural, you know, like things that are funny in their culture are also funny in ours. And so it was just really great across the board watching or reading a play and also performing in Red Sisters on stage as well. But the other one is Larissa Fast Horse. She has this amazing way of telling things that other people should not do or say to Indigenous people without saying it outright. She has just this beautiful way of writing it, and there's a couple actually Indigenous cast member in it, but it's completely relevant to like our situation. So it's just very clever, and I'm like, you know, these are the type of artists I want to really, really follow and learn from.
Thank you all for sharing. So the last question is, where would you like to see theater go, and how would you like to see it improved?
I'll go ahead and start. So I, through all of this and during COVID and with all of us, like, I know a lot of us have said this has been a huge time for reflection. And through all of this, like, I hope to see theater go places that push the boundaries of being comfortable. You know, there's so many stories to be told and so many different ways to tell them. And every culture has such, kind of like what Courtney was saying about like her stories and how people didn't fully understand the way she was writing these stories. And you just think of like all of these different aspects that we can bring to the table of these different stories, different ways of telling stories, and just really pushing the boundary. And, you know, in college, I wish I had learned some more ways of doing that. And a lot of it was like through device work that I ended up doing. But yeah, like telling these stories that, like, you know, open up imagination. You know, you think about all of these different cultures and ways that they have, like, you know, morals to their story, you know, opposed to the usual like fairy tales that we kind of bring up. There's so many different options. And, you know, and also at the same time, we're exhausted of seeing movies being made into musicals and things like that. Like, you know, there's so many stories. And I hope that during this time, it almost brings a flood of like, of this, like, of all of these stories from cultures around the world and, you know, people and the BIPOC community that just come out of the works and that, you know, people now want to get into and start doing. And yeah, that's where, like, I would hope to see theater go from here.
I absolutely love that answer. And I'm so sorry. You want to go ahead, Archelaus?
Go for it, bro.
I love that answer, Lucas. I think, you know, we talked about, like, Hamilton a little bit ago. I'm going to preface this by I love Hamilton. I still listen to the soundtrack, but I kind of loathe it a little bit for kind of, like, reskinning the story of frankly terrible white people and just using people of color as a mechanism for telling those stories. And, you know, Lucas, I'd love to see more stories about people who are typically told, oh, your story isn't important enough to tell in America, right? People who have been made to feel like their experiences and their place within this country is so insignificant in the grand scheme of things, when in reality it's not, right? I think that's a message that hopefully Utah Theater Company specifically can walk away with, just because maybe you all can attest to this, but I did high school theater, and there just like weren't stories at all that weren't about, you know, white people typically. And that's one of, like, it was a really disincentivizing thing for, like, to want to explore who I am as a person, what kind of an artist I want to be, and how we can transfer that passion onto other generations, right? And if we want Utah theater to continue being relevant and continue growing in a progressive way, those are questions that I think the Utah theater scene is really going to have to interrogate within itself and, you know, put in the work to tell those kinds of stories that typically they're not comfortable telling.
And I think this year has been great for that, facing the discomfort. I think it's just been so traumatizing in so many ways for everyone that I think we were all forced to face our most authentic self and to look at the human experience and to look at the ugly, the raw. And I want to see some work come out of this last year, and to see that, you know, we're all humans, and in one way or another, we're kind of the same. And there are lots of stories to tell. And so I'm excited to see more stories about people that we don't usually talk about.
Yeah, something Courtney said actually is how you talked about, you know, the stories that you wrote about your lived experiences on the reservation, you know, people didn't quite get, but it boggles my mind because, and this is coming from somebody who absolutely loves Shakespeare, but, you know, we watch Shakespeare, we engage with it, and, you know, people are like, oh, that old timey language, that old English, you actually get used to it after a few minutes, you know, if you really listen. And one thing that I would love for theater, specifically Utah theater, well, just theater in general, is if one day, you know, that we could apply that same sort of pass that Shakespeare gets to stories like, you know, like Courtney wrote, you know, stories that Keslie once told of Polynesian culture, you know, stories that I want to tell about Filipino culture, you know. Speaking of Shakespeare, I mean, what was it? He had 30 some odd plays of his survive into his historical fact. But he had a contemporary, a Spanish contemporary, Lope de Vega, something like that. I'm butchering it, who had over 300 plays survive, you know. Well, why aren't we telling those stories? You know, why aren't we telling more stories of that? Because we have the capacity to understand them, you know. We always talk about a human story is a human story, and you know, if it's something that is human, you know, something that's so basic that we all experience it, I think that culture in this case is irrelevant, that we can tell those stories and we don't have to worry about what audience is gonna like it. At least I hope that's what we can sort of get to in theater and storytelling.
Thank you. Any final thoughts before we wrap up this panel? Yes, Song.
I think it's important to also talk about having a safe backstage environment, you know? So I also did AIDA. It was a different production company, but when I did AIDA, it was really eye-opening because there was a backstage segregation going on. And I was the only Asian in the cast, and I was literally in the middle. And I just felt so awkward and unsafe, like, during the whole run of AIDA last year. But this year, I just got out of A Christmas Carol, and that was the very first time that I had the most safe, like, theater backstage environment. And it was, and just having that safe environment and knowing that, it brings so much to all the other actors, and like, it just brings so much happiness, creativity, more passion, so much love. It literally enriches the show more and more and more as the day goes. So I think we also need to be really aware of having a safe backstage environment in theater community, you know, and keep talking about it.
Definitely. Thank you. Thank you all so much. Oh, I'm so sorry. Did someone?
No, Latoya. It's just me jamming.
No, seriously.
I just wanted to say also, like, to piggyback off of that too, it's like the positions of power as well just need to be different as well. You know, backstage, I think we always focus on like what stories are being told and who gets to tell the stories, but also it's like those who produce the stories and who run the theater companies, the gatekeepers essentially, they need to change as well and be held accountable too. So, yeah.
Definitely, I agree. And yeah, definitely with the pandemic 2020, that's really helped me think about the web safety, both physically, emotionally, mentally, everything. So I'm glad that we can all hold these companies and institutions accountable and hopefully create a better and more safe space on and off stage. Thank you all so much for joining in on this discussion tonight. I thought this was wonderful, it was very productive. Before we depart, I just wanna remind our viewers that this panel is part of Another Theater Company's panel series. And the next panel will be LGBTQ+ in theater, and will be available to stream beginning February 4th through the company website at anothertheater.org and on the YouTube channel. If you would like to make a tax-deductible donation to Another Theater Company, please visit the website at anothertheater.org and hit that donate button on the top left corner of the webpage. Again, thank you all so much to everyone for taking the time to promote progression, positivity, and self-reflection tonight. And thank you all for sharing experiences, advice, and thoughts with us. I'll see you all next time.